Do you know what? No. Error handle. Error. No. Being able to. Handling failure scenarios can be challenging. Being able to understand all the edge cases is, well, a problem. Well, I'm going to send you over to Alex from Temporal, and he's going to teach you how you can, well, recover from errors, you can fail faster, and so much more. Basically, helps you ship that code faster with an open source tool from the folks over at Temporal. Enjoy.
Handling edge cases takes a lot of our time. They could require rollback, manual intervention, or worse. Hi, I'm Alex from Temporal. I'm going to show you a system that provides state tracking, error handling, and audit logging features to save cycles and improve reliability. Let's get started. Today I'm going to walk you through creating a temporal workflow for a sample e-commerce order fulfillment use case. I'm going to do this in Temporal's TypeScript SDK. I'll show you some common failure scenarios and how Temporal handles them gracefully. Then I'll add some interactivity in the workflow with a human-in-the-loop scenario, and add some asynchronous logic to show you how Temporal can handle complex use cases. I have some mocked out Temporal activities in this workflow. Process payment, reserve inventory, and deliver order. These are the steps I want each order to go through. I'm going to start my Temporal worker. This is the process that will execute my workflow and its activities. Now, let's run this workflow. The workflow is going to return relatively quickly, and I'll navigate to the Temporal web UI, which is running directly on this machine as part of our open source client. If I navigate into this workflow results, you can see here the visual representation of the event history. This workflow ran three activities: process payment, reserve inventory, and deliver order in order, and that completed the workflow. If we scroll down, we can see the input and output that was sent to and from each activity, as well as how long each of them took to run, in this case, about a second each. And that's a complete temporal workflow. We see some input on the left and some output on the right. Okay. That was a workflow that had absolutely nothing go wrong. Now let's see how we can complicate things. Okay. For example, I'm going to start running a second temporal worker. Now we have two workers running and ready to accept this workflow. I'm going to resubmit the workflow, but then I'm going to quickly kill the initial worker so it's no longer able to process the workflow further. The second worker will now communicate with the server and pick up the workflow in order to run it to completion. You'll see here now there's some activity going on in this second worker terminal. If I navigate back to the web UI, you'll see we've got a second workflow that was completed successfully. In this case, you can see the first worker was able to process the first two activities. There was then a gap during which the second worker woke up and began polling and was able to run the last activity and successfully complete the workflow. Great. Now, let's see what happens if I resubmit the workflow. I allow the still running worker to begin processing it, but I kill that worker midway through. There are now no workers available to process the workflow. We do not lose the workflow state because it is retained on the server, and we just have to run an additional worker that can then come alive, resume processing it, and successfully run it to completion. So we see here our third workflow. Once again, the first activity was able to run, all the workers went away. We then restarted the worker, and the last two activities were able to run successfully. We still have all of our state and all of our history retained here, even when there were no workers available. Okay, great. You've seen an example of temporal workers engaging to ensure workflows can run successfully. Now, let's add some additional error scenarios. For example, I have here some code that will cause one of those activities, reserve inventory, to fail the first four times that it's run. It'll only complete successfully on the fifth attempt. I'm going to restart a worker. And resubmit a workflow. If we navigate over to the web UI, you'll see this workflow is currently running, but this reserve inventory activity is all red. It's having some trouble completing. So far, it's failed and has retried twice, three times. And we're going to see Temporal continue to retry the activity, sometimes with a greater backoff coefficient on subsequent attempts. until eventually, on the fifth attempt, we're simulating an API coming back up. It's able to successfully complete the activity and, in turn, complete the workflow. Once again, we didn't lose state. We didn't lose the result of the first activity. We were able to run them in sequence once this external API became available again. Okay, I'm going to comment this back out. Now I'll show failing faster. As part of the input data we have submitted to this workflow, we've got a credit card number that is in the future, like it's supposed to be. If we change that to being in the past, you of course wouldn't want Temporal to retry an expired credit card, you just want it to fail quickly. To do this, you can designate certain errors as non-retryable. In this case, we have a credit card expired exception listed in our non-retryable error types, and we have our activity designed to throw that credit card expired exception when it encounters an invalid credit card number. Now, if I try to rerun this workflow, we see immediately we get some failure output returned to our terminal. And if we navigate back to the web UI, we finally have a failed workflow because we wanted this workflow to fail because it received some bad input. So you can see here the stack trace, all the associated error messages, and you'll see exactly which activity that workflow failed on because we wanted it to fail on process payment. Great. Now I'll show what happens when you encounter an unexpected error. Let me fix that credit card number first so it's back to normal. If we were just to have an error thrown in the middle of the workflow between activities that was a bit unexpected and didn't have any information associated with it, we'll rerun our workflow. Now, the workflow hasn't failed. If we navigate back to the web UI, we can see it is currently running, but we have an alert that a workflow task is failing. We have a new error, it's unexpected, and it's occurring between activities. Temporal will continue to retry a failing workflow task because it knows that it shouldn't necessarily be ending the workflow. While it's stuck in re-executing, we can remove this error, wait for the worker to refresh the change, and voila. Temporal is able to successfully resume execution and successfully complete the workflow as before once the error has gone away. Now you've seen some temporal error handling. Next, I'll show what happens when you want a workflow to receive some manual intervention or manual input. I'm going to update the workflow example we're looking at to include an instance of a signal handler in our workflow code. Temporal uses signals for any workflow that needs to receive some kind of manual input from an external source. That can be a human in the loop, or it can be a different application that's communicating with your Temporal application. In this case, we've got a signal defined called approve order. We have a handler for that signal right here, and we're going to block between activities and wait to receive that approve order signal before the workflow is allowed to progress. I'll go ahead and resubmit this workflow with the signal handler. I'll then navigate back to the web UI, and you'll see this workflow is running, and it's just waiting for the signal. The worker's not blocked, the worker's just not processing anything because it knows that the workflow needs a signal to be able to proceed. You can send a signal from any Temporal client, which includes our web UI, our command line client, and any of our SDKs. In this case, I'll send that signal directly from our web UI. The workflow receives the approve order signal, it's no longer blocked, and all the activities are able to run and complete successfully. Great. Now, in that case, you had the workflow blocking to receive that signal, and nothing else would have ever happened if it never received that signal. It would have been stuck running indefinitely. What you might want instead is to add a timeout so that if a workflow never receives a signal, it's allowed to expire. In this case, I've added what's called a race in TypeScript to sleep for 30 seconds and then time out if it never receives that signal. So it'll block only until the timer expires. I'll go ahead and rerun that workflow. navigate back to the web UI. And this time, you'll see the same thing as before, but in this case, there's a timer running for 30 seconds. And if this workflow doesn't receive that signal, instead of allowing the activities to complete, it's just going to time out. So I'm going to try to race this workflow here by sending that approve order signal. And we'll see here that it received the signal after about 25 seconds, and it was able to successfully run all the activities and then complete. Okay, you've seen some examples now of Temporal's error handling, its ability to fail over gracefully, distribute work among workers, and block and wait for input for any other applications that might be communicating with your Temporal application code. You can get started with the open source Temporal project now. Our command line client includes a dev server. You only have to install a single binary, import the SDK library in the language of your choice, and start building. Join our community Slack, check out our project tutorials, and when you're ready to scale up, consult our deployment examples or sign up for Temporal Cloud, hosted on AWS. Check the link in the description to get started. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the AWS Developers YouTube. Thanks for watching.